Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the last lesson of the Indian Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons course on hip arthroplasty. Can one of you just unmute and tell me if my audio is clear?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. This 45 minutes to 50 minute talk will conclude our arthroplasty workshop, which has so far met with overwhelming success. The delegates, 18 in number, have loved every lecture and have repeatedly watched our talks. I get the counts from the YouTube statistics. And at the end of this class, once again, on our course group, I shall be posting all the PDF files, all the presentation converted to PDF, and one interactive PDF file containing a link to all lectures, which are for your exclusive use. As you have paid for the course, please do not share these with others. Let me start my talk today by sharing my screen. There you go. I'm sharing my screen, desktop one. And let me start this here. And that's my view. Good. And IAOS Arthroplasty course, last lesson. This talk is about the instrumentation for total hip arthroplasty. Old English proverb, a bad workman always complains about his tools, but good instruments make all the work rather easy. Especially in things like arthroplasty, it is essential to have good instruments to perform a proper surgery. Sir John Chanley, in his times when hip replacement was very new, would insist that all the trainees who came to him to learn hip arthroplasty should get a complete set of instruments before they embark upon the surgery. However, unlike total knee instrumentation, there is no standardization of hip instrumentation, not implants, hip instrumentation. Unlike total knee instrumentation, there is no standardization of hip instrumentation. What does it mean? With knee replacements, as at least 12 designs are popularly used, the instrumentation varies with the prosthesis used. However, all knee instrumentation is based on only one design patented by Hungerford and Kenna. Each of these models will have its own specific cutting blocks, and a surgeon has to vary the instrumentation depending on the implant design that he is using. With hip replacement, this is not the case. More with cemented and to a great extent with cementless hips, the surgeon or hospital can own their own instrumentation set, which would be useful in all variety of implants, all designs of implants. The only development after surgeon John Chanley and his original instrumentation have been in areas of femoral rasps, where the rasps themselves act as a trial and trial head balls can be introduced onto them prior to reduction. Apart from this one newer introduction of instrumentation, the original hip instruments, as described by Chanley, are still the same with no change. The first instrument is a Chanley retractor, which is a self-retaining retractor, and the two clamps can be, the distance between the clamps can be varied. This does the job of two assistants detaining. I think somebody's audio is not muted. I'm hearing some disturbance. Give me a minute. I'll mute the audio. I have to mute. Sandeep was not muted. And yes, there we go. Okay. Then one more. The next instrumentation is Hohmann retractors. I have close to 11 to 12 Hohmann retractors of various designs, and with just three Hohmann retractors, we must be able to get a 360 degree view of the acetabulum. So Chandy retractor and Hohmann retractors will ensure that we are able to get a clear exposure. Sorry. A power saw is very useful for cutting the neck accurately. A giggly saw can be used, but one should not be trying to cut the head with a chisel or nibble it off with a nibbler, as was done in the older times for Austin Moore prosthesis. Head has to be measured. You get swivel trays, you get head measuring devices. This is my design of Prakash gauge measurer, which is a stainless steel anodized plate with holes starting from 1 millimeter up to 60 millimeters, increasing in progressive increments. So this can be used for measuring K wires, drill bits, taps, THR heads, hemi heads, bipolar heads, and everything. And of course, the patient's anatomical head. This is a conventional swivel tray, which has been in use for ages. Measurement of the head and the diameter of the acetabulum is more critical in hemiarthroplasties like mono and bipolar hips, rather than in total hip arthroplasty. These are the acetabular sizes. They come in various materials and colors, which each company wala has made. This was my design made many years ago, which will measure the diameter of the acetabulum. These are the acetabular trial balls, which I had introduced for doing a trial reduction of a hemi head. These go on the rasps and a trial reduction can be done. And these are the acetabular trials and head balls for trials. So for doing a trial reduction, both this and this has to be seated on the prosthesis. Acetabular reamers, the commonly used one is called a cheese grater. However, this gets blunt rather fast. Another issue is most surgeons do not keep their instrumentation as personal instrumentation and depend on the manufacturing company or the implant manufacturer to supply hip instrumentation on a loaner basis. That instrumentation goes from hospital to hospital and is put through so many cases that many times we get these reamers which are totally blunt and incapable of cleaning the interior of the acetabulum. I personally inspect these cheese graters the day before surgery and ensure that they are sharp. If they are not, they either need to be sharpened or you must instruct them to get a better and sharper one. Else, you can invest in these type of reamers. This is actually a hardened steel with diamond cutting, which will go and do a beautiful grating. As you can see the design, it locks onto the power reamers. And this instrument was marketed by me many years ago. I think one or two people have copied this design. I'm not sure whether it is available in the market anymore, but this is a wonderful instrument to beautifully ream the interior of the acetabulum. That's a power tool, and these are essential for reaming the acetabulum. In Chanley's time, he did not use power for his heparthoplasty, and he had Hudson brace with which he would manually ream it patiently and use a hand drill to make the anchorage holes. But with the availability of power tools, the job has become extremely simple and easy. So those are the detachable blade reamers, and these are the diamond tip reamers which I have shown you previously. This is the handle on which it goes, and the whole thing goes on a power tool. This is the original acetabular positioner by Chanley. This angle is at 45 degrees, so that will give you the correct inclination of the cup. And by rotating this either anteriorly or posteriorly, we can get the, again, somebody is not muted. Please mute yourself when you come in. Please mute yourself. The echo is very disturbing. Thank you. So then by moving this up and down, we can control the anteversion or retroversion of the acetabular cup. A very, very important instrument, the box chisel. This is the starter. An accurate use of this is essential to ensure that you have a valgus seated prosthesis. And this piece, the tip here, goes as way back into the trochanteric fossa as possible to ensure that we start at a correct point. There you see, posterior part of trochanter. This goes right up to the posterior part, and by rotating the box, we can ensure that our version is correct. So this is the lesser trochanter, 10 to 12 degrees anterior rotation from the lesser trochanter as far back into the trochanteric fossa as possible is the most correct orientation for entry of the prosthesis. You can see how that's the lesser trochanter, that's the greater trochanter, and how far back into the greater trochanter the box chisel is being seated to ensure that we get a perfect entry into the femoral medulla. These are T brooches which will enlarge the medulla up to the isthmus. These are for the short stems. For longer stem, you get longer T brooches. Some companies also provide a power tool for this, but I personally like to do it manually. After the box chisel has made its entry, we go as far back posteriorly as possible, aiming for the medial part of the femoral stem as the tip brooch gently enters into the femoral medulla. These are the rasps, which are fixed handle rasps, the traditional type, right from Austin Moore to original cemented Chanley. These rasps are useful for reaming or rasping the medulla and producing a cavity suitable for the prosthesis. And these are detachable femoral rasps, which are rasp cum trial, meaning that attaching it to a handle, you use it for hammering inside, and then you can attach a head ball on this area to do trial reduction. These are trial heads for ME and total, and trial stems of various sizes. However, if you are using the previous design of rasp cum trial, you do not need separate trial prosthesis. Heads of various neck lengths and diameters as trial is available. This remains constant, the diameter, depending on the situation which you are using. The depth inside in the 12-14 taper is the one that decides whether the head is a long head, long neck, medium neck, or short neck. And only that relevant area of the head of the neck will enter into this when it is locked. So these are the trial femoral components. They match the size of actual implants. With cementless implants, the trials are smaller than the actual component by 0.5 millimeters, so that final fixation is rigid and solid. These are the trial femoral components, and those are the trial heads. And that is a cement plug introducer. This is to introduce the cement restrictor into the medulla. There you see, as far back posteriorly is the entry point, and the plug is being introduced and it's being pushed in. Dr. Arun Gupta, you are doing a blank page writing. Please desist. Arun Gupta, or I will go and I'll stop sharing and I'll clear my screen first, and I will add this. 1 minute. Sharing, advanced sharing options, only host. Okay, done. Now I can share. So now I think you can see me. That 1 minute. One of you, can you unmute and tell me if you can see it clearly? Can you see my screen?
Yes, Dr. Prakash.
Yes, good. So 1 minute there. A 6.5 millimeter drill on a power tool. This is used for making multiple drill holes. And again, having a power instrument makes it far, far easier than doing it manually. Cement mixing bowl. Companies are giving disposable bowls these days. However, Sir John Chanley always uses stainless steel bowl and a spoon. I am using the same bowl for the last 25 years, which was the soup bowl from my mother's kitchen, and it has served the purpose well. All you need is a container and spoons to stir it. The cup positioner and pusher will depend on the type of implant you are using. However, the cup positioner and pusher have two essential elements. One element is the one to see the inclination or coverage of the cup, and the rod on the side is to define the anti and retroversion. Some acetabular positioners have a special marker to delineate the anterior and posterior walls of the acetabulum. And in those situations, we find that the long posterior wall can be positioned properly and posteriorly. That's a femoral head punch. And the one on the right is a modified punch that is used to take away the head from the stem. So these are the various femoral head punches. They always have a Teflon tape, and there's a carbon fiber element to ensure that as you tap, you do not scratch or you do not damage the femoral head. So those are all the instruments that are needed for doing a total epartroplasty. It's a known fact that good instruments make a good surgeon. Please remain well equipped and well prepared. Good planning is half the battle won. Take home messages from this course, not from this lecture, but from this course itself. These are what I call the 12 rules for total epartroplasty. I learned them in Liverpool, Wrightington, England, some 30 years back. I have been following these very religiously and stayed out of trouble. As more and more younger surgeons going doing more and more epartroplasties, even for non-indicated cases, the problems will increase, and in a few years' time, the load of revision on a revision arthroplastic surgeon will get tremendous. To avoid that, and in the best interest of patients, we must follow these 12 rules for total hip arthroplasty. The rules are based on evidence currently available in literature, and I have made special efforts to ensure that I only use universal and absolute rules rather than being either dogmatic or being impressed by a commercial company or publicity given by an implant manufacturer. I'm only speaking science which has been proven. Cemented hip should be the first choice in patients above 70 years of age, as it would then be expected to last the patient's lifetime. As has been explained on the previous lectures, cement gives absolute stability and immediate weight bearing, which should be our first concern. Invariably, people above 70 have an osteoporotic bone, a wide medulla, and that ensures that cement plus hips may not get a very stable fit. Even if the bone stock in an older patient is very good, I would always prefer a cemented hip in those above 70 years of age. Another absolute rule is patients younger than 55 years of age should be asked, offered a cementless hip unless he cannot afford it. That is because the osteolysis after a failed cementless hip is far less than that from a failed cemented hip. And revision of a cementless hip, except for specific porous coated designs, is relatively less complicated than revising a cemented hip, because the removal of cement needs not only special instrumentation, but it's very time consuming and difficult. So below 55, you have no doubts that you are going to use a cementless. Above 70, you are going to use a cemented. In between 55 and 70, the choice is yours. And depends on the patient's level of activity, comorbidities, expected lifespan, and financial implications. The crux of the point is, in the current evidence, both cemented and cementless hips will last comfortably for 20 years. A well-performed cemented hip may even last for 25 or 30 years. So you always base your thought on how long the patient is going to live with your hip inside his body. Third, current evidence does not show the superiority of either a HA-coated or porous-coated stem, and the choice is entirely surgeon dependent. So if you are using a cementless hip, you can use either a HA coated or a porous coated stem, and the choice is entirely the surgeon's choice. A word of caution regarding Indian hydroxyurea coated hips, which I have seen in the last week, two Indian manufacturers representatives have brought samples to show me, and I could simply scrape off the hydroxyapatite with my fingernail when I scratch the surface of the hip, which speaks of very poor coating and makes it practically useless for cementless implantation. I am not decrying our local manufacturers in general, but hydroxyapatite coating and porous coating needs sophisticated technology, and one must be very careful about the brand of the implant one is using and try to get independent tests if possible. Try to use the smallest head possible to get the thickest poly, and 28 to 32 mm heads are the most commonly used. With the advent of XLPE, they say that even larger heads like 36 and 38 millimeter can be used. And during Dr. Simon Thomas's talk, he had shown you some 36 heads and 38 heads that he had used in hip arthroplasty. But in my 30 years of experience, I have never used a head bigger than 32 millimeters for any reason whatsoever. Secondly, I prefer to use 28 millimeters. My other preference would be 22 millimeters in a smaller built patient with a smaller diameter of acetabulum, because I always believe that you must get the thickest thickness of polythene above your head. I repeat, the polythene has to be as thick as possible, because after the initial 10 years, there is almost a 0.5 to 0.8 millimeter per year wear of the head, and thus thicker polythene cushions better and causes less deformation, thereby causing less wear. 5. A metal on poly articulation is the most economical gold standard. Next is ceramic on poly. This costs higher than the fancier articulations, and the cost has not been justified by long-term follow-up. So ceramic and ceramic is purported to last longest. Ceramic on poly is supposed to last longer. There is some evidence of lesser wear in ceramic on poly, but no conclusive evidence of a 25-year follow-up showing either the superiority of ceramic on ceramic or ceramic on poly, for a simple reason that ceramic technology is coming in the recent times, and thus the same has not been in use for a long enough period for us to confidently claim that they are worth the exorbitant cost the companies charge from us. Furthermore, all the ceramic components in the world are made by only one company called Ceramtech, who holds the surgical world at ransom by charging exorbitant prices for both the ceramic heads and the ceramic shells. Metal on metal articulations in the hip has been proved to be disastrous and useless. Except for one design, which is called the Birmingham hip, which is a surface replacement with a 500 plus micron clearance, which has stood the test of time, all other metal on metal hips have been failures and have been withdrawn. McKinn, the designer of Birmingham hip, is now currently in trouble in the United Kingdom, not related to the design of the hip, but because he had taken away the removed heads or the shavings from the head to his house to perform personal studies, which was not liked by the people of, by the health authorities. And he has been hounded, and they are doing some case against him on Organ Transplant Act. I'm really unsure what stupidity is happening, but we as orthopedic surgeons must support Dr. McKinn, because what he was doing was only studying for science. If planning for hybrid hips, use cementless shells but cemented stems, because it has now been shown that shell incorporates well into the cancellous bone, and the lysis at 10 to 12 years is lesser than cemented hips. However, cemented stems distinctly perform as good or better to cementless at least during the first 20 years. In cemented stem and cup, the reaming should be 2 to 3 millimeter large on both sides to allow a uniform cement mantle. This means if you are going to use an 8 millimeter stem, diameter stem, lowest diameter stem for the femoral medulla should be reamed to 11 millimeters. If you are going to use a 10 millimeter stem, it has to be reamed to 13 millimeters or even 14 millimeters. Likewise, if the outer diameter of the cup is 50 millimeters, then the acetabulum has to be reamed to 54 millimeters so as to give a uniform 2 mm cement mantle all around. This is a very, very important step. Exact opposite, in uncemented hips, both the acetabulum and the stem reaming should be 0.5 millimeters lesser than the implant size to allow a tight fit. So, cemented, give 2 millimeter clearance. Uncemented, keep 0.5 millimeter minus so that the actual implant can be compacted and impacted firmly, allowing earlier weight bearing and mobilization. Very, very, very important. The stabler cup should be 45 degrees to the pelvic axis and 15 degree antiverted or away from the recipitator, often following the actual neck. I repeat, a stabler cup should be 45 degrees to the pelvic axis and 15 degrees antiverted so that it provides a good coverage to the head and does not cause dislocations. I must add at this stage that head size doesn't prevent dislocation. We have seen dislocation with hemiarthroplasties with head size of 47 or 49 or 51. Whereas we have seen 22 millimeter Chanley heads being absolutely stable. So, exact critical positioning of the acetabulum and the femur are essential to ensure that the hip is stable and does not dislocate. The femoral stem should be in slight valgus with the stem facing or touching the medial femoral cortex, and a varus lateral cortex touching the stem should be completely avoided. In certain cemented hips, the inventors have advised a central placement to allow a more uniform cement mantle all around the stem. However, I always swear by a valgus orientation stem, and I personally have more than 25 to 30 years follow-up of my patients with ancient cemented Chanley, all poly cup and stem, some done even with trochanteric osteotomy, which I've lost effortlessly for 25 years because I had taken all efforts to put the stem in valgus. Magic cocktail and beta 6 block, I've already taught them in the class. The cocktail consists of xylocaine, bupivacaine, adrenaline, gentamicin, ceftriaxone, and 40 milligram of dipamethorol, and that is injected layer by layer, starting from pericapsular layers to intramuscular to subcutaneous tissue and skin. And immediately after surgery, when the patient again lies flat on the bed, a beta 6 block, which is one finger breadth lateral to the femoral nerve. Here, 3 milliliters of 0.5% lignocaine injected will allow same day walking, and in the newer arriving modality of day case hip surgery will allow same day discharge of the patient. Hope you enjoy the course and learn from it. Certificates and books have been sent, and in case you have not received them, please message me. We are not dismantling the group. We will keep the group open. Stay in the group and stay in touch by posting your cases in the group. All PDF lessons so far, all PDF files of the lecture, PowerPoint presentations, and links to the talks will once again be posted on the group. Please keep it safe in your hard drive. Please do not share these lessons as you have paid for them. This particular lesson, however, I'll be posting it free on the internet because the rules of orthoplasty needs to be expressed and shared in a more popular manner. Indian Academy is also conducting the following courses: Elizarov technique, biological methods of fracture management, distal sodium channel block and pain portals, and Miraz course. And should any one of you be interested in joining, please message me personally. Participants of this course will get a special offer for the other courses. And please share the course feedback to me or in the group. Thank you very, very, very much for being with us and having attended the course. We have all our participants, more or less all our participants are here. I will leave the house open for questions. If you have any questions, please unmute your mic and ask me questions. In case you cannot think of questions straight away, you can always ask the question in our iOS WhatsApp group. If you want to type your question, you can type it here itself. And if you want to ask me, please ask me. Any questions? I do not find any questions here. Nobody is raising his hand. Everybody seems comfortable. So let me end our class with a special thanks to all participants. My thanks to the other three faculty, Dr. Vijay Sharma, Dr. Mithin Achi, and Dr. Simon Thomas. And those of you who have not received the certificate and books, please message me and I will ensure that my staff is instructed appropriately. Thank you very much. Have a nice Sunday. Enjoy.